Yes.
Hi, Dave.
Hey, how are you? I was just picking my nose, and you.
I didn't know. You didn't tell me you were going to pick your nose. I would have stopped.
But it wasn't on the recording.
We'll see.
We'll see, right? Okay.
Oh, throwing pens already. Well, I just wanted to revisit the whole idea where we started when we started doing these Facebook videos. Who knew a year ago that this is where we'd be in September of 2020? But we started doing this because I was, and our world was desperate for knowing what doesn't move when everything feels like it has gone away. So we were thinking about structures and biblical context for the world and what is happening. And so we've landed on a few different topics that you've talked through, some old messages, some iconic messages, maybe. Mm-hmm. And here we are talking about the Beatitudes. We've talked through quite a few already, and today we're going to land in Peacemakers. So there's our intro.
That's it. Matthew 5, verse 9. Okay. Matthew 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. That's what the text says. One of the fun things we've been doing, Annika, with these Beatitudes is that there's the text and there's all the teaching there, but I've, for almost every one of them, I have memories of, particularly when I first preached this thing back in 1986. Isn't that something? That it's kind of stood the test of time. It really has. It changed the DNA. But around this peacemaker talk, what I remember was it kind of rocked the boat a bit. It stirred things up, and here's why. It'll be maybe obvious now. At 27 years old, when it was going, why is this creating a problem? I kind of get it more now. But here's why. Because for a lot of people, a peacemaker was that person in the family or the church or the workplace or at the PTA meeting, whatever, right? Whose job it was to keep the peace. Sounds nice. The problem is that they often would keep the peace. They would do it by ignoring the issues, avoiding conflict, denying a problem. That's the person whose job it is at the dinner table to change the subject if anything gets over here, because we're going to go crazy if we talk about that or that kind of thing. Okay. So that's the peacemaker, but that's not a peacemaker. That might be a peace keeper. And what you get, and this was, again, back in the day, this felt like, wow, a revelation. Because, I mean, you reflect on that. That's how we do family. That's how we do church. And sometimes you need to just not, we don't want to, anyway, that's going to take about all the things we can't talk about now. And peacemakers, by the way, is a good thing to talk about in this polarized, wow, politically, racially,
cancel culture,
whatever.
Cancel culture.
Yeah, I'm not cool. I don't know what that is, but it's bad. But I mean, there are times like that we keep the peace by just not talking it through and stuff like that. But the point is that when you get that kind of peace, like we're gonna get peace by not talking about what's real, mm-hmm. what you'll get is peace out here. But you don't necessarily have any kind of internal peace in here. So peace out here means, okay, we're not yelling and we're not screaming and we're not hitting and nobody's shooting, but there's still resentment and there's still anger and there's still dysfunction. And so you get peace out here, but no peace in here. That's not peace. In fact, the prophet Jeremiah in Jeremiah 6:14 puts his finger on this when the confrontation of God through the prophet was, you treat the wounds of my people lightly, meaning you don't get down into what's really creating the pain, because what you do, instead of getting into what's really going on and hurting people, you just say peace, peace. That's the text. Because you treat the wounds of my people lightly, saying peace, peace, everything's okay, when there is no peace. And that made God angry. I mean, that's where that word comes from. It was pretend peace. another memory around this text, the when we originally preached it, Jeff Van Vonderen was on our staff at that time, and he was fairly new to that, the craziness of those days. But he came, Jeff, some of you remember, some of you don't, but Jeff came, was a friend of mine in college and in seminary, but he came to us from a chemical dependency background. He had kind of faced his, actually his own alcoholism and stuff like that, had gone to Hazleton. But out of that, he got an education. He dove down deep into family systems and issues of codependence. In those days, those words were brand new to us. Codependence, what is that? Family systems. And he introduced this phrase called the no-talk rule. And you just said the no-talk rule is one of the indicators of a dysfunctional family or a church. And the no-talk rule is that you just can't talk. Now, nobody had heard that phrase back in the day. Everybody knew what it meant. You know, oh yeah, I know what that is. Never heard that phrase before, but everybody knew what it meant. And as, when you began to think about it, you start going, ooh, it's everywhere. It's, you know, it was at the quarterly meetings at church in, back in the day. It's in families, churches, marriages, like I said, the PTA. And it's how, you, the no-talk rule in some systems is how you keep the peace. By just not talking about it and shutting up to people who might, and the people who might talk about it are the bad guys. That was another phrase that emerged from that season, that you're the problem if you say there's a problem. I remember having to help people realize, and Jeff was part of this as well, no. For you to say there's a problem is not the problem. The problem is the problem. It's amazing, though, as we talk like this, I'm thinking anybody listening could go, yeah, I could see how that could blow things up and be disruptive.
Right.
If that's not just how we're not all agreeing yet in those days. Yeah, this is how we think, and this is how we are going to operate. So anyway, so the problem is, and I've already said this, with that kind of peace, you get a peace out here when we're not talking about what's real, but you don't get real peace in here. So there's no yelling, but there's still resenting. There's no hitting, but there's still seething. There's no acknowledging of what's really going on, but the elephant is in the middle of the room and everybody knows. And, but because we're not upset about saying, and we just call that peace. Hmm. I have a memory of when Bonnie and it was around the hit the wall time. And we were just in so much, it was such a wonderful transformational time, but we went into counseling then. And out of that whole thing, I developed a, like, how to help couples know when they need counseling. And one of the things that drove us into counseling is, if you can identify the issue that you can't talk about without fighting, that's what you need counseling for. Because that's what happened to us. We all of a sudden, we just noticed, in every other way, we got along really well. But there was this one thing, quite frankly, it was church. She wanted me to leave. Nobody knows that. Please leave the ministry. And not entirely. It was that she wanted me all the time. That was the problem. And I just couldn't.
You are just digging yourself a huge hole here.
I know.
I can't wait to watch you dig out.
Who's going to fire me? Anyway, sorry. But that was huge. That was huge. Like this thing we couldn't talk about. And every time we went toward this particular issue, we just didn't know how to do it, and we couldn't find peace. And so that's where we needed, and that's just a little tidbit for couples. There's, by the way, there's nothing crazy nuts about you. If that's an issue, you probably need a referee. And then I think sometimes that's what a good therapist is. Teach you how to talk about it so you can get real peace, in-ear peace, settled kind of peace. John 14. Jesus says, famous, you know, well-known verse, peace I leave with you. Wait. Claire, my peace I give unto you. So no, don't just go to peace, because you all have this weird idea about peace. My peace I give unto you, and not the way the world gives peace. And I'm not saying like the whole world, but in a generic sense, the general way on the front end of getting peace is this whole thing of getting it out here. It deals with the problem externally, so we quit dropping bombs, but we still can't stand each other. There's no internal resolution. It gets people to stop shooting and yelling and confronting, but they're still raging and resenting. We could unpack this in a lot of ways. This is the kind of topic that's worthy of a retreat where we send people off in small groups now and talk about that in family systems. Like talk about how that manifests in the family you grew up in and what were the no talk rules. I mean, right. That'd be an incredible thing to just talk about. What are the talk rules? What are the no talk rules now? But in the same thing is like churches. I think I remember when I came to Open Door, it was like you couldn't ever. It was like what this peace out here, but no peace in here. So we didn't yell, but we never said the true thing. What it allowed was it allowed for the most immature, controlling, and whiny people in the church to run the whole show. Because no one would ever say, "Wow, you're a baby." I don't like that kind of stuff. Because it would, and nobody would say that. That would be mean. But we couldn't get at the kind of things that would bring real peace. So we just kind of gave in to immaturity often. And I'm not saying back in the day, it's easy to go back there. But I think you know what I'm saying. And there would be this no talk rule. And anybody who would break the no talk rule was in big trouble. So let's kind of get to this thing about God. God desires peace in families, in churches, in the world. Jesus is called the Prince of Peace. Mm. But the peace that Jesus brought and was committed to was not born of, it didn't get birth from silence, avoidance, and pretending. Peacemaking was not characterized by appeasing. And here's the key verse. Here's the key verse. James 3:17. I'll never forget when this thing dawned on me. It was kind of fun. It says, it's talking about wisdom. And James says, wisdom that's from above is first of all pure. And in that context, what the pure means is true, unmixed, authentic. So the wisdom that's from above is first of all true. Then it is peaceable, okay, and easy to entreat. Here's the deal. Wisdom from above is first of all pure, then it is peaceable. So the only way to get to peace is through the truth. Mm. That's like a big thought that needs to be thought about. So you can't just go, oh, we have peace. No. Have you dealt with the truth? Have you talked about the dysfunction? I mean, when we came to faith, okay, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, even Jesus dying on the cross was about, we couldn't just go to peace without the truth of our sin. So we got to peace, but we had to go, and Jesus had to go through the truth about our sin to get to peace. So that's kind of a, whoa, that's a big concept. And so what I would say, that I would say that same thing a different way, is that any form of peace, family, church, wherever it is, that isn't first going through the truth, and it is not dealing, first of all, with what's real and pure, is pretend peace. Peace.
It's like a counterfeit.
Mm-hmm. Well, it'll probably be some form of the external thing. And sometimes we settle for that, and sometimes we need to settle for that. But we aren't experiencing, we're not getting, that's not a peacemaking kind of thing. You have to deal with the hard thing to get the real peace. So let me say it some different way. Wisdom from God finds its way to peace, not by pretending nothing's wrong, avoiding hard conversations, ignoring sin and dysfunction, appeasing the least mature. Wisdom finds its way to peace through the truth. I already said that. Confronting what is real, exposing what is false. Problem. Everything I just said is, I think it's true. But if you release that, you got to tell the truth. You got to tell the truth on a whole lot of people, and particularly people who have an axe to grind or whatever. This is a really dicey thing. It can land on immature people, and all of a sudden they're telling the truth, and they have really no desire to heal. Their agenda is really not to bring peace. They just want to blow somebody up. And it's the truth. And so I would just want to put that caveat in there that this is not for the faint of heart. This whole thing really requires a kind of, I think, maturity to want to break the no talk rule, not just to go, you idiot, you know, but to bring real, like, I really want to reconcile with you. Now, all of that brings up, and this is where this whole thing in some ways is going, this weird paradox about being a peacemaker, because and it's just that if you're a peacemaker, what I talked about at the beginning was peacemakers are often the person whose job it is to avoid the hard thing and avoid conflict and all that. Ironically, if you really want to be a peacemaker, if I'm right about this, that actually is somebody who's willing to enter conflict, which is totally opposite what I think of when I think originally of a peacemaker. A real peacemaker would be needing to be willing to rock the boat, which doesn't look like they're making peace. It looks like they're making trouble. Right. A real peacemaker would have to be willing to tell the truth, to break the no-talk rule. And, you know, anybody that you know, Annika or I know, who, let's say they're in a family, let's just use the extreme example of an alcoholic or abuse. Abuse is going on. And it's been going on and going on, and nobody's going to say anything. There's a no-talk rule, and you don't talk about our family outside the house. But I promise you, anybody that God has ever used in a family, in a church, to finally say, we're going to break the no-talk rule and say out loud, because we would really like to have some peace in here rather than just this phony stuff out here. I promise you, whoever does that at every level, they will pay a price. So there's a really high price for this. Matthew 10, Luke 6, Jesus said these very weird things. Do not suppose that I came to bring peace. Wait, what? You ever read that verse? I thought, what? I mean, he's like, I got to put that in the book, the crazy things Jesus said.
Yeah.
Like, I am the Prince of Peace. But I didn't get, what are you thinking? I came to bring peace, but a sword. I came to set a man against his father, a daughter against their mother. I thought he cared about peace. Didn't he care about peace? He cared about peace, but the peace he brought dealt first with the truth. It came through the truth, and honestly, in almost any family system, that doing that is going to create strife.
Yeah, initially, for sure.
Initially, yep. Especially if we don't know how to talk about it, and that's get counseling thing. Sometimes you actually need somebody to help you talk about that stuff. Same thing with Jesus and the Pharisees. We beat the Pharisees up, 33 weeks we've been doing this? For 32 weeks we've been beating up the Pharisees. But I mean,
and
Jesus
many
said,
more weeks to come.
Yeah. But Jesus said, you know, woe to you scribes and Pharisees. You polish the outside of the cup and of the bowl. And when he told them that, he was confronting them, and that was the truth, and no one would say that, and everybody knew it. Why did he do that? Didn't he care about peace? He absolutely cared about peace, but not phony peace. So it would be really good to get to an internal kind of peace, because the only way to peace is through the truth. Acts 24, verse 5. I love this. This is near the end of Acts. Peter is before Felix, one of the rulers, and he's defending himself in some fashion. And Felix says of him, that we find Paul to be a pestilent fellow. He's a pest. That's what the word means. And I'm thinking, why? Why did they call him a pest? And I think part of why they called him, because he was a pest. I think he ever saw a fight he didn't like. But I think ultimately the reason Paul was considered by Felix a pestilent fellow was he never settled for external quiet. He wanted real peace, internal truth. Peace, but that only came through the truth ever. So anyway, I got that out of order, but I would bring that up again, this idea that, you know, you for some people this whole thing sounds like permission to just blow people up, and so this is, I don't even know how to help people other than you got to be honest about your own heart. A real peacemaker will not pretend, will deal with the truth, will break the no talk rule, but their aim, their desire, their heart is to heal and to restore. And if that's not your desire, you'll blow things up and it won't bring any peace at all. But you'll be right. We know all about that kind of. Mm-hmm. Don't call that this. I just wrote this thing down here, and maybe it's just a thing to think about. But it's fascinating to me when we think about how peacemaking is kind of full of paradoxes. It's fascinating how the enemy perverts the truth, because if he can't get you or me with a rebellious, angry heart, which is what he can get us with, and all of a sudden you're kind of, in terms of kingdom purpose, you're not going to be very effective. If he can't get you with a rebellious, angry heart, he'll turn a tender heart into a mushy heart. Hmm. And the mushy heart, oh golly, I'm using it as a type, but they won't tell the truth. They won't do the hard thing. He'll take a truth like, blessed are the peacemakers, the enemy will, and lay it on a gentle, obedient heart and turn the message, blessed are the peacemakers, on a gentle, tender heart and turn it into appeasement. Mm. And that's not, and without knowing it, all of a sudden, here you are, really good person, love God, and you don't want to have any conflict, but all of a sudden, because you won't say it out loud, what you're actually doing in the church, in the family, you are allowing, sometimes in a family, abuse.
Right.
Just keep going. Sin and abuse to continue, all in the name of peace. Nuh-uh. Bottom line, call to being a peacemaker is a call to bring healing and forgiveness and grace and reconciliation to a lost and dying at war world. Mm. And we live in an at war world, not by pretending, avoiding, ignoring, but with a heart to heal, bring peace to homes, marriages, and work. One more thing, it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons or the daughters of God. And so I'll just keep that simple. I just throw a question at this. So how can you spot a son of God? How do you spot a daughter of God? Well, you prayed the prayer. I don't care if you prayed the prayer. I don't care if you prayed the prayer. You know what I mean by the prayed prayer?
Oh, yeah.
A son or daughter, all that's, I can tell. It's like Jesus is going, here's all you'll know. They're the ones changing the subject and avoiding conflict at all costs. No, they're not, right? No, the way you can spot a son or a daughter, they're the ones bringing light into dark places, bringing truth into false places, bringing reality into pretending places, bringing grace into legalistic places. That's how you can tell. Those are the sons and daughters of God. But every person, I said this already, that God uses to do that, going to pay a price, which ironically explains the next verse. The next verse, I remember thinking, when I was doing the Beatitudes, every one of them flowed, like from the broken people are mourning people, and mourning people are meek people, and it all flowed. And then after the peacemaker, he said, Jesus said, blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of doing right, for making peace. Blessed are you when men or people insult you and speak, say evil things about you falsely. Why would anybody say anything mean about a peacemaker? Well, now you know. Because they tell the truth, not looking for a fight. But when you start breaking the no-talk rule, in order to get real peace, there could be conflict. And Jesus did that all the time. And then he says this, that's how you can tell who a son or daughter is, because they bring that. They break the no-talk rule. But blessed are those who are persecuted. Rejoice and be glad if you're persecuted. Two reasons. One, your reward in heaven is great, which is great. I'm never comforted by that one.
Me neither.
No, it feels too far away. Okay, good. I'm getting my butt kicked here, but heaven, good. I'm going to get something.
I'll have a really pretty crown.
A nice ice cream cone. extra, whatever. Yeah. But actually, the reward in heaven, I'm silly there, but there's something eternal about that. But the second thing is, so were the prophets like you persecuted before you. So what he's saying there, there's nothing, there's no blowing smoke there. What's amazing to me is what he's saying is that every time you tell the truth into lies, every time you bring light into the dark, you will get what the prophets got. And so rejoice and be glad. Why? Because you are in line. You are in a very long line of men and women who told the truth no matter what. You're in that line.
Well,
okay. You know, sign me up. Well, don't, you know, be careful. But you have no idea. I just thought I was confronting the abuse in my family. No. You when you told the truth there and brought it into the light, you got right in line with the prophets who did that. And you know what they did, the prophets. They killed the prophets. Rejoice and be glad. anyway, so I'm making light of this, but it isn't light at all. And you know,
No, teasing. I mean, my eyes are, we're just filling with tears there because I think it's so relatable for what is happening in our world and those of us that are raising kids or watching their kids raise kids or working with this next generation that is coming behind us in any way, shape, or form. I'm aware that the way that I speak to my kids, the way that I teach my kids, the way that I'm speaking truth to the situations that they're in right now, it's not just because of a math assignment. It actually is for their entire future. The ways that I'm speaking and working and the things that I choose to say or don't choose to say. And I loved what you said about, I'm finding so much crossover with the Beatitude that we did before, which was, I think, pure in heart, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this idea of pure being a full integration, not just about being good.
Right.
And the pureness that you were talking about in reference to peace. And then I'm thinking about that Hebrew word shalom and wholeness.
Right.
So this idea of wholeness and integration and God, how badly I want that and how hard it is to achieve right now. And then the comfort we have in what God promises us at the end. Because it's not easy.
No.
It's not easy to ask the hard questions and say what's true.
And I think that it can get scary. I mean, when we get out there, but I think also, it would be good for everybody to kind of dial. When are those times when I identify those times when I told the truth, but I really didn't want peace. I wanted to blow them up. Or when Paul says, speak the truth in love. And speaking the truth in love, telling a truth for the purpose of healing is the most vulnerable thing you'll ever do.
Yeah.
Because I'm an 8 in the Enneagram, so I can often use the truth to blow you up, you know. And so you won. No, you didn't win anything. You didn't win anything. And but to come to say, I really, here's the truth. And to be really loving them, speak the truth in love and wanting to reconcile, if you're not coming with a sword at all, just the truth, there's the potential that they can have a sword of their own. And so I've also seen healing with that too. Lots and lots of healing with that. You just hang on to that too. I mean, lots and lots of authentic healing. So there's real peace. And because you had the hard family meeting, we've had none of those.
Liar.
I know. It wasn't a lie. I was kidding. Anyway.
There's so much to, I mean, this is why counselors and spiritual directors and pastors and all these people that have made a living and a vocation out of walking alongside people that need to speak the truth.
Yeah.
it's a part of discernment. It's a part in of love. Wisdom. It's like, yeah. Yes, in love. There are whole professions dedicated to walking people through what it means to tell the truth and find that wholeness and pureness, full integration. I feel like that's what we spend our whole lives doing, right? Yep. Living more fully into who we are. And so much of that is God's truth for us. So it's also super easy.
So yeah, it is.
We'll just leave this one right here.
Well, I think too, I think there are some, we're going to sit on this for another time. I have somebody, maybe we'll be able to bring them on, but we're going to sit on this because it bleeds into other issues as well. And
so many.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, you know, anybody on Facebook, I don't know how much people interact with this, but if there's, you know, with this kind of, what about if there's questions or something like that, you know, fire them away and the ones we like, we'll answer.
The ones that are easy, we'll get right to.
Yeah.
Well, Dave, thank you so much for sharing this part one of Blessed Are the Peacemakers. Mm. Not to be mixed in with the idea of peacekeeping, mm-hmm. right? And the dysfunction that comes from that. So thank you. See everyone.
Bye-bye. Thanks, Annika.